two SH-101s and a 303 and an 808. That was basically the main main things, and then also an Akai S-900, which was like a sampler. So it was a mixture of old and new in a way, like at the time. It was actually recorded. It's a young lady called Nicola who lived on my estate, and the actual vocal was Nicola's voice reversed. We actually reversed her vocal over the forward vocal, which that's what created like that hypnotic kind of sound. So like when she was going ah ha ha, yeah, that became a ah ha. And it's like, so you get like two things kind of passing each other. Such a funny sketch, and I was like kind of still having a way of like an avid collector of spoken word records and everything. At first I wanted to do like one of these kind of, you know, tunes where you've got like loads of different bits from all these, you know, samples from this track and that track, and but I couldn't quite concentrate enough on the sampling part of it because it was all really new to me. So I decided I would make a tune and then just use a sample in it. And basically, which I still kind of do now, is like I picked a bit of the tune and then built a subject around it. But what happened was that there was not enough memory in the sampler. So I kind of ended up using only Voodoo Ray instead of Voodoo Rage, because he said Voodoo Rage. But I didn't have enough space to on the sampler to put the whole thing in. So yeah, it just ended up as Voodoo Ray. Yes, the way I play my live sessions. First of all, I'm gonna tell you, like, I used to play in the old days in a way that nobody else used to play. I used to have this machine called a TR-808. And I used to use that as my clock and also as a big booming bass drum sound that you hear on every single tune today. And out at the back of the 808, you have like three trigger outs. So I could have three things, separate things, being triggered in time from the 808. So I used to run an audio cable from the back of the 808 to an SH-101. And then I would use the internal sequencer in the SH-101 to write my bass lines. And then I would run another cable out and I would plug that into another SH-101 and use that to write the lead or the top line. And then I would also use the DIN sync out of the back of the 808 into a 303. And that would be another sequencer, so you could basically go on forever, and then like you could basically then take another sync out, a DIN sync or something, because I used to have a splitter, and connect that to like a 909 or something like that, and then a percussion machine you could also use, and before you know it I'd have an orchestra, so I'd an entire like set of like drum machines and synths, all separated, not really like, you know, like today how people would do it with MIDI. Like in the old days, like everything had its own sequencer on board, and like basically we just had one clock that ran everything. That's how I used to do it. Right. Today, I do exactly the same thing, but in the laptop. crew called the Scratch Beat Masters. And basically we used to DJ, we had break dancers and graffiti artists, and we used to go around terrorizing people in Manchester and the local neighborhoods with music and dancing. And from 1982 till 83, I was totally engrossed in this culture kind of thing. And we got into like the cutting and scratching side of things and mixing. So it was like scratch mixing and like trying to learn how to do things like phase backs on it's basically like anything you could do with two turntables and a mixer and some vinyls, like it was totally in there, and was trying to push the limit of it to where it could go. I was always intrigued by like how a vinyl was made, you know, because like, I mean, like we used to literally try and take them apart when we was cutting and scratching. It was just like how can we make this into a science, more or less, you know what I mean? And that was kind of one of the crew that was pushing more for like actually making live or real music than just cutting and scratching. Well, yeah, it was the attic at my mom's house, actually, where I used to have like an amazing sound system for a kind of residential house anyway. Felt sorry for everyone around there. And yeah, I practice and stuff on there and learn how to do bits and pieces. And eventually when I managed to buy a TR-808 drum machine in about 1986, and I kind of didn't really look back from there. I bought an SH-101, found a Roland 303, and got hold of a little four-track, Tascam four-track machine, and started building my own tunes. Without the knowledge of what was going on in Chicago or Detroit at the time, I was more or less like looking at or being inspired by what was coming out of New York, like with the electro-funk stuff. I can remember it was like a local group called Chapter and the Verse. One of them came out of my house one day and said that there's a little label in New Brighton who were interested in releasing some of my acid house music, or he didn't actually call it that, but like it was like interested in releasing some of this new type of music. And I was like, okay then, like, you know, how are we gonna do it then? And said they would give me some studio time. So it was actually in May of 1988 where I went into the studio and recorded, I think I've still got a track sheet somewhere. I think we recorded like five tracks. Four of which ended up on an EP. One of the tracks was Voodoo Ray, one was called Blow Your House Down, one was called Escape. Is there Escape? And I can't remember what the one was called. I think it was Rhapsody in Acid or something like that. And yeah, that basically was the first thing that I'd put on a vinyl. To do it, you can make anything sound like anything else. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Like this bass line, say, on this tune, I've got from like a sample loop somewhere, but originally it sounded totally different. You know? Mm-hmm. I'm gonna play a little bit of this riff so you can hear it. And I've made it like that so it goes with the bass drum, which is like this. Originally, that bass drum, I mean the bass guitar, sounded like this. And I'm this is the original bass loop. Let's cut the decay down so you can hear the tune of it. So what I did was, like, I've gone into the program and I've taken slices of the bass line, I've taken notes from it and rearranged them, but in a way, not just randomly rearranged, I actually found a way to make a groove out of it, or like a different pattern, by taking maybe like one part. Is an easy way to do it. You take like one part and then you repeat that, and then you add variations to in between the repeated parts. I would say be yourself, be individual, find yourself. Maybe try and be. It's not easy. I don't think it's easy to say, but you know, try and look at what's around you, and like draw from it. But like if you find that you're copying something, you know, be disgusted by it and try and move away from it and do your own version of it, or try and do something new, you know. Try and find a blank canvas. Really hard nowadays, but try and find a blank canvas and throw a bit of paint at it and then paint around it, you know, and like, you know, you'll stand out. You will. I mean, like, because there are so many people because it's so easy to just cut and paste, they're cutting and pasting, and when everything starts to sound like everything else, if there's one person who's doing something in the totally opposite way or totally different, they will stand out. I mean, I always think there should be a little hint of like selfishness where you're making something for yourself. I think you should start off making it for yourself and then like maybe grow out from that, you know, just so that you it actually has a core or a personal kind of thing that is you, and sharpen your skills. You know, it's like anything that you do, if you keep on at it, you know, it'll get better. I wish that I had like a studio in a box when I was 16. it was like really something I focus on, like, you know, I'd spend like days just like creating like the right reverb on a snare drum or something, or a hi-hat, you know, and then I could press save and it would be saved. Like when I was doing this stuff back in the days, like you couldn't just save, you know, you had to actually find a way to recreate it like live. And I suppose in a way that created a way of me being able to not look and shape like a sound with a waveform, but like nowadays you can do something and save it as a patch or whatever, and you know you'll still have it. And being able to do that and build upon that process, I think, you know, you can create so many new things in the world of this type of music. This is A Guy Called Gerald signing out. I hope what I've said is been of use to some of you people out there.